Can you separate the art from the artist? I'm of two minds about this. Sometimes you want to do that, and sometimes you don't. But let me try and explain why it's complicated. Hey there, this is Perch. I think this is an old phrase, the separate the art from the artist. And it's one that I've been thinking about more and more lately, because as comics has become polarized, much like everything in Western society is polarized right now, there's a problem where a comic can be put out. It's a comic people don't like. And it could be for a number of different reasons. Either a comic is aimed at a certain audience and the people who don't like it are not that audience. Maybe there's a big disappointment that a storyline just didn't go over the way it wanted to, or maybe the creative team was overtapped. I mean, I think, like, for example, I think Ron Lim is a really nice old school penciler. I really think he's good. But lately they've been having him do the full art duties, the penciling and the inking. And you see a drop in quality. Ron Lim was better when he had an inker. And I think most, as I've discussed before, most artists are. But, you know, I think that there's a number of reasons why a book just might not land with people. I mean, again, a bunch of reasons. But it's become more common that, you know, say a creator goes on a crazy drunken tear on social media, calls people out, or, you know, doesn't, you know, no shows. It's funny. Sorry, I'm interrupting myself a lot. There's this talk about creator bad behavior, and I see various things like, oh, this creator said something political against the other candidate, or this creator did this or that. There's a lot of little issues people will throw out from the creators. And the one that never seems to get mentioned, but to me is like the biggest cardinal sin of creators where comics are concerned, is when they no-show signing appearances, or if a comic shop goes to the trouble, promotes their appearance, maybe pays a ticket for them to fly in. That's happened from time to time, not recently, but it's happened. And the creator doesn't show up, or shows up like a rock star, like 3 hours late, or, you know, any number of things. To me, that's the worst bad behavior from creators. Certainly a lot worse than, you know, a creator going on social media and saying, I hate Trump. But when you see these kind of endless video rants about creators at times, they'll go into the, this creator has something against Trump. And I get it. Maybe you like Trump. But I that, in terms of the grand scheme of things, you know, getting a bunch of fans excited, having a store put some financial things out for a creator, and then the creator just not showing up is so much worse. I mean, in terms of, you know, a tweet, in my opinion. I even say, you know, creator goes and blockbots a whole massive swath of fans. I mean, it's bad behavior in the sense that creator is sending a pretty, you know, go away message to people who are supposed to be paying customers. I think that's bad, but it's less bad behavior than just dumb behavior, in my opinion. But anyway, I think that this kind of a bad behavior of a creator starts to affect the work. And I think that makes sense. A creator is just a real jerk. You meet him maybe at a con or something, and the guy's, you know, offensive or wants to charge too much, or just really super rude. Then the next time you see his comic, you're probably less inclined to buy it. And it probably takes away from the reading experience. I think that completely makes a lot of sense. But I don't think it necessarily goes the other direction. Let's say you pick up a comic and you don't like it. It falls flat. It's just, it's not good. Or let's even say worse than that. Let's say they take a beloved character that you've always admired and they kill them. Or they, you know, and I mean, in the case of X-Men, they take Bobby Drake, they make Bobby Drake gay. Or they reveal that he's gay. However you fall on that side of things. What does that mean for the writer? I mean, I think it's fair game to say this was a bad issue, or what the hell is this, or this dialogue is terrible. I think the word cringe is way overused, but you know, this issue is, you know, cringe. But when it gets further into this writer is trash, this writer is a trash human being, that's the kind of stuff where I just kind of scratch my head of, have we not, why have we not been able to separate the art from the artist? I think good people can still make bad things. It doesn't mean that they're bad people. I mean, another example might be, you may hate Tom King's Batman run. You may hate every single thing he's done to Batman. You just it's no good. It's bad. But I see some of the vitriol, some of the anger at Tom King personally, that doesn't, to me, doesn't make a lot of sense. I mean, yeah, here's this guy, he's writing Batman, you don't like it, but to say, you know, this is the worst human being ever to walk the face of the earth, I mean, some of this stuff is like, I don't get how you get from point A to point B. And I also think, you know, there's a case where if the writer is clearly writing something for a different audience, and I wrote about this recently of, you know, Rainbow Rowell, young adult author, comes into comics, gets put on Runaways. Runaways is probably, of all the books, is probably the most clearest kind of young adult book. More so than like Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur is, you know, young girl, young adult character. I think Miss Marvel probably fits that bill of being kind of young adult. Captain Marvel is not young adult, it's adult. You know, I mean, but I think if you were going to say, hey, let's get a young adult drama book, Runaways is probably right there. I mean, I is there a better example of a young adult drama book at Marvel? I don't think so. So hiring Rainbow Rowell to write that comic seems like it makes sense, right? If you're opening up a French restaurant, you look for a chef that cooks French food, right? You wouldn't go and hire a specialist in Chinese food for a French restaurant. You hire the French chef. And so it seems like that's what they did with Rainbow Rowell, and she comes in and she does her run. And there's been so many, like you see so many complaints about this run of just, oh, this is garbage. This is the worst comic ever written. It's trash. It's terrible. This author is trash. Why is this author employed? This is garbage Marvel. I hate Marvel. I hate everything to do with Marvel. Never again, Marvel. And I don't get that reaction on a number of different fronts. Again, one, you know, the Runaways is clearly intended for a specific audience. If you're not in that audience and enjoy it, you enjoy it, great, good for you. But if you're not in that audience and you don't enjoy it, you should ask yourself the question, why am I reading it? I mean, it if you love kind of 90s image books and you are into, you know, Hickman's X-Men, or you like kind of dark and gritty Frank Miller Batman, you probably won't like Runaways. 9 out of 10 fans of those comics will not like Runaways. So don't read Runaways and you won't be disappointed. But in terms of the person, and this is the part that I kind of scratch my head about, I do think there's, you know, many different types of creators. There's ones that are, you know, really, I think they outreach to the fans, they work really hard, and there's ones that are more aloof, they don't do things, and there's ones that clearly convey a I'm better than you attitude to the customers. Unfortunately, that's the one that gets me the most. More than just outright aggression, it's the ones who really put themselves apart from others. And Rainbow Rowell as a creator, I mean, again, consistently, I find that this creator is extremely nice to fans, to readers, to people who are critics. I mean, I mean, she'll get irritated at times on Twitter, but it's far and few between, and that irritation is so mild. Like, I don't know, I look at her often and I say, this is somebody who's got just Teflon skin, because people will come at her and her book with the most insane, nastiest comments I've seen. I mean, that book is a magnet for really, really angry comments. And yet, she just seems to be cool. She doesn't seem to really jump in and get angry about it and hangs out. And on top of that, it's a person who she is really clear about her schedule and her signing appearances and what she does. And when she has to cancel, she is apologetic. She offers to make it up for people. It's good creator fan relations, and yet she personally gets trashed. Again, I don't think there's anything. There's nothing wrong, nor should anyone stop behavior of saying, I don't like this comic, or this comic page is dumb, or look at how this character is drawn. I mean, there's some art in Runaways that looks weird, you know? There definitely is, in my opinion. Again, everybody likes different types of art. But there's some ways that characters and things are represented that are strange, and I think you can look at that issue, you can look at that page, and you can go, yeah, this is weird to me. I don't like it. I wonder, it's raining like crazy. I wonder how much that's picked up on the video. I guess I'll find out. I always think I talk a bunch, and then this crazy rainfall happens, and I listen to it later. It's like, nobody can hear me. And then, you know, I've wasted my time talking in the car. Anyway, I wonder how many people who are parked next to me think I'm in some kind of really engaging business meeting, because I talk with my hands often. So even when I'm doing this video, I'm gesturing to nobody. And I imagine people driving by me are like, look at this crazy person. Holy cow, it is really raining hard. Anyway, the point here, I guess, and I'll try and wrap this up because good chance that this video is going to be ruined anyway by the weather. I think that as readers, as fans, I do think we have a responsibility to be able to, you know, judge our commentary, judge our, or, you know, at least temper our reactions to the issue and not allow it to spread and bleed out to everything. I think, and recently I had posted some pictures from a Captain America issue that were just bizarre. But some of the responses I got back were equally bizarre. Like this page right here is exactly why I will never give Marvel another cent of my money again. This and after they screwed Richard Meyer. And it's like, okay, the first one is crazy. This is one comic. And if you think that there was ever an era, ever in comics, where every single comic published in a month was perfect, with, you know, panels that looked great and nothing that was goofy, you are high. There's never been that moment in history where there haven't been goofy issues. Doesn't mean we shouldn't make fun or can't make fun of those pages that look weird, but nothing has ever been perfect. The second is this kind of idea that some people and their behavior outside of comics, on social media or in the public, has poisoned or tainted our ability to enjoy things from a publisher. I mean, that one, I get a little bit more. I do understand that, you know, you can get pushed too far to the point that you won't support a publisher for their stance on other issues. I get that. I think still you wind up missing a lot of good stories if you take that view. But, you know, I can't fault you for taking a stand against something that you see is wrong. So I think that one's more normal, but the first reason, just because you know, this comic doesn't, you know, this comic offends you in some level because it told a bad joke or did something stupid, or God forbid, it made fun of Trump in some way. I mean, this is one page out of 1,000 pages that are produced every month. And I just, you know, maybe it's indicative of 80% of the comics, but still then there's that 20% that are telling stories you might want to read. It's just my opinion. Again, you can read and buy whatever you want. And the statement I always make that people sometimes forget is, it's your money. It's your wallet. It's your money. And whatever you do, you should be putting your money where you feel comfortable with it. If you don't feel comfortable giving Marvel one penny, that's your choice. You're the consumer. It's your cash. And you know, the worst option is you hate the company and you give them your money anyway. That's worse. So don't do that. But I would just say it helps in life if you can compartmentalize a little bit. And you'll find that you enjoy more books and you get more things to read. And I think that's a good thing we're all about. But anyway, that's what I got to think on the subject. Let me know what you think. Leave a comment below. I do want to say, just again, heartfelt, Rainbow Rowell, you are a really decent person. You communicate well, and I know comic shops really appreciate that, and fans appreciate that, and a lot of creators who have been in this business for, you know, years or decades even, could learn a little bit from your example, because you do a very good job of communicating what's going on and trying to do the right thing by your fans. And I think that is very admirable. And unfortunately, more the exception than the rule in many cases. So thank you. But like I said, leave a comment below, like, subscribe, recommend this video to a friend. Tell people they can join the party. Follow me on Twitter @ comicperch, and thank you for listening.